Hi there, this is Long John Neville. Back on August 17th, 1956, I started doing an all-night radio show in the city of New York. Whether anybody was listening or not, it's hard to say. I imagine some of my family listened that first night. As time went on, I'd say 2 or 3 weeks later, I started to meet some people that accidentally heard the show, and they said, "Why don't you do this? Why don't you do that?" Everybody had a suggestion. I happened to meet one man by the name of James Mosley, and he told me he'd like to be on to talk about flying saucers. I had never heard of flying saucers, except maybe read something in a newspaper one day, and I didn't think that I was going to take a chance and let my potential career as a broadcaster go down the drain with some kook talking about flying saucers. But I must admit, after doing 5 hours alone, night after night, one day I weakened, and I called this fellow Mosley up, and I said, "Come on over and tell me a story." And he did. Since then, I've been talking about them many times. I thought you'd be interested in hearing Jim, some 10 years later, since I first met him, telling us about some of the things that have happened to him during the past few years. And I decided to take some segments of the shows that I've been doing on NBC and put them together so that you could hear it once, twice, a half a dozen times or more, and start to really figure out for yourself whether there's any truth. Jim, I wonder if you could define flying saucers for me. I think I have a definition, but I'd rather hear yours.
Well, the actual term came from Kenneth Arnold. You know, when he had his sighting, he saw 9 gleaming objects at some distance over Mount Rainier as he was flying his private plane, and he described them later to the press, and they asked him just what these things looked like, and he said they looked like saucers skimming over water. Mm-hmm. So you know how the press is. They came up with a new cute term, and we're stuck now with the term flying saucer. Actually, it's a object of any sort which can't be identified as a conventional thing, such as a plane or a meteor or a guided missile or a bird or a hoax or a illusion. It would be anything that remains unidentified after a sufficient effort is made to find out what it is. It's a UFO, or, to put it in better language, an unidentified flying object.
Well, now, you were the man who founded and the editor, I guess, of Saucer News. And this has been published for how many years now?
14 years, John.
Well, now, after some 14 years, and I know that you've had many people appear at these symposiums that you're responsible for, many of the important names in flying saucer field. Do you honestly believe any of the stories?
I do believe the little men stories. There are hundreds of cases throughout the last 20 years in which people in all parts of the world, especially South America, Europe, and a few parts of this country in Canada, have claimed to have seen craft land right in front of them in broad daylight in many cases, and these little creatures, 3.5 to 5 feet tall, get out.
You used the word creature. A moment ago, you said little men.
Well,
I think there's a difference between a creature and a little man.
These are humanoids. They look almost like us, but they look perhaps like dwarfs more than a normal human being, and they are smaller.
Not a midget,
a dwarf. Mm-hmm. Their heads are oversized, their arms are shorter.
Just the body is smaller.
That's right. Mm-hmm. And there are other differences, too, but that's the main one. There's a difference in this respect that they don't speak to anybody. They're shy. They run away when they're inadvertently seen at whatever they're doing. Usually they're interested in our soil, in samples of water even, or anything that has to do with our vegetation. Now, these creatures act differently and look differently from the type of tall, good-looking, idealized human image sort of people that Menger and the other contactees see. We might, however, be being visited by more than one race at a time, and conceivably some of them do look like us. I'm on the fence with some of those stories, but for the little men stories, I'm pretty well convinced that most of those are true. Menger, as I said...
What are the color of these people? Because I've heard green and purple and all.
No, green is the one color that, of course, is ridiculous. I mean, in the sense that this is...
Why is it ridiculous?
It's a press term that's been invented by the press to disparage the whole thing.
All right, you're an expert. You tell me the color, then.
Well, the colorings range from white to brownish, sort of generally the same range of skin colors we have on Earth. The costumes involved are usually shiny aluminum sort of thing, with or without a sort of a space helmet.
Metallic costume.
Yes,
not
that's
necessarily
right.
Aluminum.
Well, that's right.
That's a
looking,
question at the end of that. That's not a statement.
Right, looking like aluminum, let's say, but certainly not necessarily being aluminum. Sometimes they're said to have on a space helmet, sometimes they're not. But the consistencies are that they don't attempt to talk to anybody. There's only a few of these little men stories where there's any communication at all, and when there is, it's on a very trivial level. Never philosophy, never ways of banning the bomb.
For a moment, what about the language?
Well, if they speak at all, it's in the language of the person spoken to, and it's always in perfect dialect of the person who's being spoken to. But usually there's no communication whatsoever. Now, the people that Adamski sees or saw, and that Menger saw, and Dan Fry, and the other people that you and I both know, they always look like we do, only a little bit better. You know what I mean? The idealized...
Golden eyes and all that sort of bit.
I'd like to look like some of these people are said to look.
Sort of like a Sandy Teller.
Yes. Yeah. And they always tell us the same vague philosophical principles, which are usually very good principles, but we don't need to speak to space people to know that we should learn to live with each other and things like that. So I'm on the fence on those stories, but Menger, more than the others, I do tend to believe, because he has evidenced this sincerity, which again is important to me, and the reason he's done that is that he has changed his story through the years, as he himself has thought better, I guess, or thought deeper about some of these things. It seems that he's honestly trying to tell it the way he thinks it happened, and I respect him a lot for that, and I think that he's basing it all on something that is genuine, not just a figment of his imagination. Now, he may have gilded the lily a little bit in those early days to have a new story to come up with for each of your shows, but I think basically something happened to set him off.
I feel that there's an air of criticism in that last remark of yours.
Well, after all...
Are you suggesting that I twisted his arm every time he came in the studio door and said, look, a wilder one this time, Howard, or you're off?
No, but if I were Howard, and if I were going to be on that frequently, I'd think, well, gee, this guy wouldn't want to hear what I said last week. I'll have to make it a little bit better, or he won't have me back next week. You know, that could enter into it on his
part.
Have
you got a good one so that I'll have you back next week for this week?
I wish I did.
Let's get to these. You know, I've, to be very honest with you, all the years that I've known you, I've never heard you say this before about the little men. I mean, I know about the stories. I know that you're familiar with the stories and all like that. I must also admit I never quite understood how, you know, how you stand on any of these things. But if you indicate some interest in the little men's stories, how many people have you interviewed that have allegedly had this type of experience, whether they've talked to them or saw them? I like some of the details. In other words, if the little people did not talk to the humans that you have interviewed, how close were they?
Well,
give me some of the details.
Well, I'll give you what I think is a good example, John. In 1955, there was a very well-documented landing in the town of Hopkinsville, Kentucky. This involved a group, apparently, of little creatures about 4 feet tall that landed in the backyard of a farmhouse. Well, the farmer, or one of the farmers that was there that night, went into the backyard. He saw that some sort of a craft had landed, and he saw a small creature sort of scurrying through the bushes. The way he described it was more like a monkey or an animal, more than a human being, as we would understand the term. Well, there were with him in that farmhouse a total of 9 adults and 2 children, and they all became very frightened at this visitation. In fact, the first farmer to go outside took a shot at this creature. He hit it straight on. This is another very interesting feature that has occurred in other landings. He hit the creature straight on with a rifle at very close range. The creature fell over as if hit, but then jumped up again as if unharmed and ran away. Well, this unnerved the whole family, as you can imagine, so they barricaded themselves in the house for the next 2 hours. And during that period of time, at least three or four different instances occurred where these creatures, one at a time, would be seen appearing at a window, sort of peering in from outside and hanging onto the screen, as it were, as an animal again would do. Well, when they'd see a face at the window, they would blast at it with a rifle or a shotgun. Apparently, they had a number of arms in the house there. And they just became terrified to even go outside to see how many creatures were involved. They never saw more than one at a time. They didn't know if there were one or several. Well, finally, about 11 o'clock at night, which was 2 to 2.5 hours after this invasion had begun, one of them got enough nerve up to go out to the family car, hop in it, and go down to the local police station where he told the story. And the police, later in recounting the incident to the people who I talked to, said that these people, at the very least, were genuinely frightened. There was no doubt about the fact that the whole family was in a state of panic. But by the time they got back to the farmhouse with the deputy sheriffs and all, the craft had left, the little men had left, and there was nothing around except the empty shotgun shells, the obvious evidences of this struggle, and there were some marks in the backyard where this thing had apparently landed. Now this to me, although of course it falls short of absolute proof because you don't have photographs of these creatures, but a family of 11 people, all becoming almost hysterical about the same thing at the same time, indicates to me that at the very least something weird and unusual occurred to set them off. You can certainly argue about the interpretation as to whether they saw precisely what they saw or what they said they saw, but there's no doubt that something very, very strange happened that night at that farmhouse. Now, that's the type of story that I'm speaking of, John. There are many others, but usually there's only one or two witnesses, and this one we had a great many.
Do you have any idea of why these alleged space people or people from other planets would be coming to this planet? What would be their purpose? Gee, do me a favor. Don't give me this philosophy stuff now, will you, Jim?
Oh, no. On the contrary, as I try to envision these creatures, again, I'm thinking more of the little men than the tall beings that we spoke of before. They seem to have no discernible motive either for good or for harm so far. They are alien in the full sense of the word. They are weird. They are looking a lot like us, but their motives are beyond our comprehension. Why should they be around, as we can assume, for hundreds of years without making open contact? Why do they flee whenever
we get close? Wait a minute. You said hundreds of years. Well, we don't have any evidence to support hundreds of years,
well,
do we?
Well, the works of Charles Fort, which I'm sure you
know something about,
go into some of these stories, which I couldn't quote right off the cuff, but I know some of these little men stories go back at least into the 19th century, and the UFOs, of course, go back into all the Middle Ages and ancient history as far as that goes. So I think this is a long-range visitation, and it doesn't come to a peak or a crisis as ours would. Say we went to Mars. Well, we would make contact within a day or two, presumably, if we found any intelligent race living there. But these creatures are different. They don't want anything to do with us. They are perhaps afraid of us. Perhaps they're just interested in their own activities. We don't know. I've spoken to a couple of my friends who are working on books now, and they have investigated some of these little men cases recently firsthand, and they don't know. Nobody can come up with a motive that makes sense. That's what makes it so odd, John. There is no discernible pattern. There is no discernible reason.
Is there a possibility, because you keep referring to these people having been around for hundreds of years and they're little creatures, is there a possibility that Shaver and Ray Palmer may have something with the Darrow stories? Do you think these people could be coming from the bowels of the Earth rather than from another planet? In other words, coming up out of stainless steel caverns where cities are built.
Well, I'd go partway along with that to this extent. First of all, if you have little men that look almost like us, and if you believe in evolution at all, and I certainly have a scientific background or foundation, but the thing is, if evolution has anything at all to it, and I'm sure it does, then creatures that develop independently on another planet are not going to look much like us at all. Now, that's the point here. If these creatures look a lot like us, they must probably have a common ancestry somewhere way back. But I do think it's quite possible, as many legends and rumors would have it, that we reached a high point of civilization, let's say 20,000 years ago is a rough estimate, and that some of the people involved with the high point of civilization at that time invented machines, invented modes of power that we have not rediscovered, and that they, at that point, either took off for another planet or hid out in some far-off section of our own planet, perhaps at the poles, perhaps in Brazil, where there are huge unexplored areas, perhaps even in caves. This is quite conceivable to me. It's not as far out as it sounds, because as I indicated to you before, if these people look a lot like we do, they must have a common ancestry, and that would mean somewhere back in non-recorded history, because we have nothing in our written history about this.